Today we'll be dealing with the ventricular septal defect case-based discussion. So we'll try to understand a VSD through an explanation of a case. So this was a case which we had around 6 to 8 months back, and VSD is one of the commonest congenital heart diseases. So it's important that we understand. So how we'll do this is, first I'll go through the history uninterrupted. And after going through the history, I will explain each and every symptomatology, the pathophysiology of the symptoms in relation to the VSD. And then we'll try to come to a diagnosis based on the history. Then after that, we'll go through the examination the same way uninterrupted, then try to explain each and every symptom with regard to the VSD, and then come to the final diagnosis, then about evaluation of VSD. So this is how we'll be doing it today. So this is a 5-month-old male child hailing from Coimbatore, informant as mother, with a reliable history, presenting with complaints of failure to thrive since birth, difficulty in feeding from the age of 1 month, and one episode of pneumonia at the age of 3 months of age. So we have to arrange the history in chronological order always. History of presenting illness: failure to thrive since birth was there. The birth weight was 3 kilos and the current weight is 4 kilos. So obviously there's a failure to thrive. In 5 months, only 1 kilo has been gained. There's a difficulty in feeding since the age of 1 month, where the mother typically tells that the baby feeds for some time, becomes breathlessness and stops, and then sleeps and then feeds again and cries in between. This is the common suck-suck cycle we see with infants with heart failure. There's one episode of cold, cough and fever with respiratory distress. 2 months back, he was hospitalized for 7 days, required IV antibiotics, oxygen and diuretics. Other positive history: there was a history of increased precordial activity since the age of 1.5 months. There was no history of forehead sweating, no history of any edema, no history of cyanosis, cyanotic spells or squatting, no history of seizures or focal neurological deficit, and no history of any prolonged fever requiring admission for IV antibiotics. Antenatal history: there was no history of fever with rash, lymphadenopathy in the mother during the antenatal period, no history of drug intake, smoking or alcohol intake, no history of diabetics or hypertension in the mother, and no history of x-rays taken in the mother. The baby was born by full-term normal vaginal delivery with a weight of 3 kilos, cried immediately after birth. There was a history of NICU stay for 3 days without any complications, and there was no history of a prolonged jaundice, petechiae, seizures in the newborn period. So symptoms started with the respiratory distress or difficulty in feeding from the age of 1 month. Up to 1 month, the baby was okay. So developmental history: attained social smile at the age of 6 weeks, and now partial head holding is present at the age of 5 months. So baby was on exclusive breastfeeding, adequately immunized, and socioeconomic history we have to ask as routine. It has more importance with actually rheumatic heart disease than congenital heart disease. Treatment history: patient was hospitalized for pneumonia for 7 days. He had fever, cold, cough with respiratory distress. Was treated with IV antibiotics, oxygen, nebulizations and heart failure medications. Now is currently on some syrup which is given once a day, which increases the urine output according to the history by the mother, along with some multivitamins. So based on this, we have to summarize the history and give a diagnosis based on the history. But before doing that, to understand better, we'll go through each symptom and what its relation is to the VSD. So coming to the classification of congenital heart disease, they are broadly classified into asynotic and cyanotic heart disease. So cyanotic heart disease we'll take in another class where we'll describe about tetralogy of Fallot. Now we'll just consider an asynotic heart disease. So it's of two types. First type is the shunt lesions. That is the lesions which have a left or right shunt. The prototype being a ventricular septal defect, then atrial septal defect, patent ductus arteriosus, aorta pulmonary window, and AV canal defect. And also you have lesions where there's obstruction to the inflow or outflow, like a congenital mitral stenosis or a congenital aortic stenosis due to a bicuspid aortic valve, or regurgitation lesions, sometimes a congenital mitral regurgitation or aortic regurgitation. So these are basically the asynotic congenital heart disease. Okay, so we are going to deal with a ventricular septal defect. So shunt lesions, for example, ventricular septal defect and patent ductus arteriosus. This is a VSD, so you can see the 4-chamber view where you have the right atrium, left atrium, left ventricle, right ventricle. This is the interventricular septum, and you have a hole in the interventricular septum, which is the VSD. So the blood will go from the left ventricle to the right ventricle. Actually, the blood goes directly from the left ventricle to the pulmonary artery. That is the way the blood goes. Then to the pulmonary artery, it goes to the pulmonary capillaries, back from the pulmonary veins, left atrium and left ventricle. So the chambers which are dilated in the VSD, it's very important to understand, will be the pulmonary artery, the left atrium and the left ventricle. The right ventricle is not dilated in a VSD. The reason being is the blood jet usually goes directly from the LV up to the pulmonary artery without hitting the RV that much. So the manifestation of these shunt lesions will be, large shunt lesions will be congestive cardiac failure from early infancy. Okay, so these are the symptoms which you have to ask in the child when he's having congestive cardiac, to diagnose a congestive cardiac failure from early infancy, it will be a recurrent respiratory tract infections, difficulty in feeding, or commonly known as the Sucker-Suck cycle. In elder children, it will be a dyspnea on exertion, then forehead sweating during feeding, and failure to thrive. So we'll go through each symptom one by one. So now, before that, when do these symptoms cause cardiac failure? So with the exception of an atrial septal defect, a large ventricular septal defect, or a large PDA, or an AP window, or AV canal defect, when they cause heart failure. To know that, we have to understand what is the normal drop of pulmonary vascular resistance. So in fetus and newborn, they have a very high pulmonary vascular resistance. Okay. So this is the curvature of the pulmonary vascular resistance and how it drops as the time goes on. So with the first breath, the pulmonary vascular resistance will drop by 50%. Then after that, there's a slow drop of pulmonary vascular resistance till it reaches the normal adult level, which is indicated by the circle, to around 2 to 3 weeks of age. So in any shunt lesion, the shunt always depends on two factors. One is the size of the defect and one is the pulmonary vascular resistance versus the systemic vascular resistance. So if there's a large VSD, there will be a large amount of shunt. And if it's a small VSD, obviously, there will be a small shunt and there will be no heart failure. So in a large VSD, the shunt depends on the pulmonary vascular resistance versus the systemic vascular resistance. Basically, it is the pulmonary artery pressure versus this aortic pressure. So if the pulmonary vascular resistance is lower than the systemic vascular resistance, it will be a left to right shunt. If the PVR is equal to the SVR, it will be a bidirectional shunt. And if the PVR is greater than the SVR, it will be a right to left shunt. So cyanosis will then manifest. So the pulmonary vascular resistance comes down to around 2 to 3 weeks of age to the normal adult levels. But in patients with a large VSD or a PDA, the pulmonary vascular resistance take a longer time to drop to the adult levels, around 4 to 6 weeks of life. So when the PVR drops down to the normal adult levels, that is when the left to right shunt is fully established. And that is why in post-tricuspid split shunts, congestive cardiac failure develops between 4 to 6 weeks of life. So if you have a newborn like day one of life having a large VST, if they're telling that he's having heart failure, that is not due to the VST, that is due to some other cause. But what about atrial septal defects? Actually, atrial septal defects does not follow this trend. Because in the case of an atrial septal defect, you see the diagram over here. This is the left atrium, right atrium, and this is the atrial septal defect. Okay. So in the atrial septal defect, apart from the size of the shunt and the pulmonary vascular resistance to the and the systemic vascular resistance, the ASD shunt mainly depends on the compliance of the right ventricle versus the left ventricle. So compliance basically means stiffness. So if there's a low compliance, that means the ventricle is stiff. So the fetal circulation is basically a right ventricular dependent circulation. Reason being, the right ventricle does more of the cardiac output than the left ventricle in fetal life. So the RV is more thicker than the left ventricle, which means when the baby is born, the right ventricle is more stiffer. So if the right ventricle is stiffer, the shunt, there will not be much shunt between the left atrium to the right atrium because the right ventricle being stiff will not accept the shunt. So only when the right ventricular compliance improves or the right ventricle becomes less stiff will the shunt be established. So even these cases, even when the pulmonary vascular resistance drops to the normal adult levels by 2 to 3 weeks of life, because the RV stiffness has not decreased, the shunt is not established. That is why in the case of an atrial septal defect, congestive cardiac failure usually develops later on during the 3rd to 4th decade of life due to the difference of the RV compliance versus the left ventricular compliance. So if a congestive cardiac failure develops in an infancy, in an ASD or in a childhood, you must think of other associated conditions. So there'll be many children who can be roaming around with a large ASD and they'll be completely asymptomatic. So this is where atrial septal defect differs from a ventricular septal defect. So what is the pathology of recurrent respiratory tract infections? So you know that the shunt goes from the left ventricle to the pulmonary artery, then goes to the pulmonary capillaries, back to the pulmonary veins, then to the left atrium. So there's a more amount of blood, that is the shunted blood, which is returning to the pulmonary veins and back to the left atrium. So the left atrial pressure and the pulmonary venous pressure is increased due to this increased blood flow. So there'll be a pulmonary venous hypertension. So this pulmonary venous hypertension will lead to the exudation of fluid into the interstitium and alveoli, causing a peribronchial edema. Okay, so then there's also a pulmonary hypertension in these patients due to the increased pulmonary blood flow. So the pulmonary arteries will be dilated. This dilation of pulmonary artery can also compress the bronchi and bronchioles. So this peribronchial edema and engorgement and the compression by the pulmonary artery will lead to a air and mucus trapping in the bronchioles and in the alveoli. So this air and mucus trapping leads to an acidotic environment which acts as an nidus for the growth of the bacteria. And this acidotic environment also leads to a secondary ciliary dysfunction. So all these promote the growth of bacteria and lead to a pneumonia. Also in these conditions, the left atrial will be dilated. Sometimes the left atrial can also compress on the bronchioles and lead to the same air and mucus trapping. Then also in infant and childhood, they are not very good in coughing out the secretions. That this can also lead to pneumonias. And many of these congenital heart diseases are associated with syndromes. For example, Down syndrome, which also have associated immunodeficiency and upper airway problems. This can lead to recurrent pneumonias. And many of these large shunt lesion babies will have associated malnutrition and associated immunodeficiency, which can lead to recurrent pneumonias. And many of these small babies and infants can have associated gastroesophageal reflux disease. So all these factors play a role in causing the recurrent respiratory tract infection in large shunt lesions. So coming to the pathology for this Sacrus suck cycle. So basically, babies who have large shunt lesions in infancy, that is ventricular septal defect or PDA, will have an air hunger and a food hunger. So I'll explain these two terms. So basically, for a baby, the only exercise is feeding. So when the baby feeds, there is more cardiac output, more venous return to the shunted blood, which comes back to the pulmonary veins and LA, increase more pulmonary venous hypertension, so more respiratory distress. So at that time, the baby has an air hunger. So he is trying to feed and is not able to feed due to the dyspnea. So he gets tired and sleeps off. But his stomach is not full. So he wakes up due to hunger and cries. So that is a food hunger. And then after he becomes hungry, he tries to feed again. But again, he has a dyspnea due to the pulmonary venous hypertension and again stops. So this suck-crest-suck cycle is a pathognomic of the large shunt lesions in infancy. Then coming to the pathophysiology of forehead sweating. So you know that patients who are having heart failure, they have a sympathetic stimulation which acts as a compensatory phenomenon for the heart failure. And when there's a sympathetic stimulation, it will lead to the sympathetic cholinergic fiber stimulation which supply the sweat glands. And infants tend to have these sweat glands more on the forehead. So forehead sweating is also a common symptom of patients, infants who have congestive heart failure due to shunt lesions. But it's very important to note that just one symptom of forehead sweating does not mean that the patient is having this infant heart failure, because you would have seen many mothers who are just complaining that the baby is having increased sweating in the forehead, but the baby will have a well-thriving baby, will be feeding well. This will be the only symptom. So all the symptoms have to be taken together. Just an isolated symptom of forehead sweating does not mean that the patient is having heart failure. So when it's an older child, they can present with exertional dyspnea or dyspnea at rest. So the pathophysiology for dyspnea and dyspnea at rest is the same thing. It is due to pulmonary venous hypertension. So when it does an exercise, there's more cardiac output, more pulmonary venous and more pulmonary venous hypertension, which leads to dyspnea. So this is common in patients who have left heart failure, like shunt lesions like VST and PDA, and also mitral regurgitation, aortic regurgitation, or dilated cardiomyopathy, where they have increased left atrial and pulmonary venous pressures. Even older children, they may have symptoms of orthopnea and PND, which is paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. So orthopnea basically is when the patient lies down, he gets dyspnea. And paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea is basically when the patient sleeps. After 3 to 4 hours, the person will suddenly wake up and have dyspnea, will not be able to breathe. So the mechanisms of these symptoms are, in orthopnea, when the patient lies down, there'll be a seepage of fluid from the extravascular compartment to the intravascular compartment, and that goes back to the heart. And because the heart is already compromised, it's not able to take that increased venous return and leads to dyspnea. That is one mechanism. Another mechanism is when the child lies flat, the diaphragm is pushed up. So the diaphragm will compress the lung and decrease the compliance of the lungs, and also compress the heart, causing increase in filling pressures, and that can also lead to heart failure. With regard to paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, it uses the same mechanisms, but in addition to that, when a person sleeps, after 3 to 4 hours, he goes to REM sleep. So during REM sleep, there's a dip in the sympathetic stimulation. The sympathetic stimulation decreases, and we know that the sympathetic stimulation is a compensatory mechanism which is needed for a patient who's having heart failure. So when that sympathetic stimulation gets abolished by REM sleep, the patient develops heart failure and he wakes up with dyspnea. So these can also be present in patients with left heart failure. So just a small quiz, there are other things like orthopnea, paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. You have platypnea. So platypnea is basically a dyspnea when the patient sits or stands up. It is commonly seen in patients with pulmonary artery venous fistulas. Trepopnea is when the patient has lies to one side, either the left side or right side, and gets dyspnea. And bendopnea is when a patient bends down, it gets dyspnea. So that is due to when he bends down, there's an increase in the intra-abdominal and intrathoracic pressure, which increases the cardiac filling pressure and leads to dyspnea. So that is a patient who is having congestive heart failure, especially adolescents or adults. When they bend down, they can have heart failure. Then little about insidious onset and sudden onset of heart failure, of dyspnea. So usually most of the dyspnea will be insidious in onset, but some causes of sudden onset of dyspnea, for example, a cardiac trauma, a ruptured sinus or valsalva, an infective endocarditis, where we can have a vegetation which is rupturing the mitral valve, causing a mitral valve perforation and acute MR, pulmonary thromboembolism and myocardial infarction in older patients. So these are some of the sudden onsets of dyspnea. Then failure to thrive. It is obvious why a child will have failure to thrive. So he is, because of the sucrose-suck cycle, he is not able to feed well. So there's a decreased caloric intake. And due to the cardiac failure and respiratory distress, there's an increased metabolism. So because of the decreased intake and the increased metabolism, there'll be a failure to thrive. The child's growth rate will fail to meet the potential expected for a child of that age. So there are many criteria for which you can say failure to thrive. The more number of criteria it satisfies, the more definite that the patient is having a failure to thrive. Then this patient also had an increased precordial activity. That basically means when the mother looks at the chest, he feels that there's lots of pulsations going around in the chest. So increased precordial activity is basically due to a volume overload lesion. So in any lesion which has a volume overload, it can cause increased precordial activity. The examples will be shunt lesions like a ventricular septal defect and patent ductus arteriosus, or regurgitation lesions like an aortic regurgitation or mitral regurgitation. So, all these lesions can cause increased precordial activity. So when we came to the negative history of our patient, there was no history of forehead sweating. We've already explained the mechanism of forehead sweating and no history of edema. So we'll come to the mechanism of edema in our next slide. Edema basically means right heart failure. So in older children, you must ask a history of chest pain and syncope. Usually VSTs do not have chest pain and syncope, especially in a smaller child. Chest pain can be present with patients who have a severe left ventricular outflow tract obstruction like an aortic stenosis or a myocardial infarction in an elderly. And syncope can also be present in patients who have a very severe aortic stenosis or a very severe cardiac output. So there's no history of cyanosis, cyanotic spells and squatting. So patients who VSTs have a left to right shunt. So if patient develops a right to left shunt due to some disease like a cyanotic heart disease, he will have cyanosis. So we'll deal with that when we talk about the tetralogy of Fallot. And cyanotic spells and squatting are classically present in patients who have a cyanotic heart disease with decreased pulmonary blood flow. And the mechanism that we'll deal when we talk about tetralogy of Fallot. And there were no history of seizures or focal neurological deficit. This is also present in patients who have a cyanotic heart disease. So due to the right to left shunt, there's possibility of air or clot going from the right heart of the circulation to the left heart of circulation to the brain. And the patients also have a chance of having a cerebral abscess due to this right to left shunt. So there can be a fever headache with focal neurological deficit. So these are more in cyanotic heart disease. And no history of prolonged fever requiring admission for IV antibiotics. So this is basically the history we ask for infective endocarditis. So any patient who is having unrepaired congenital heart disease is at the risk of an infective endocarditis. So the commonest symptom that they will give is the patient had a prolonged fever which was not responding to the routine antibiotics or medications, and he required an admission where IV antibiotics were given for 4 to 6 weeks. Any infective endocarditis usually requires an IV antibiotics given to around 4 to 6 weeks. The other symptoms of infective endocarditis are variable, like they can have petechiae, they can have tender nodules on the pads of the fingers called as the osteo nodes, or they may have hematuria. But the main history you will ask is the no history of prolonged fever requiring admission for IV antibiotics for a long time. So coming to edema. So when explaining about edema, we have to explain about the mechanism of edema. So what keeps the fluid inside the intravascular compartment depends on the four forces: the capillary pressure, the plasma colloid osmotic pressure, which is the proteins in the blood vessel, interstitial fluid pressure, and interstitial fluid colloid osmotic pressure. So any mechanism which causes an increase in the capillary pressure or a decrease in the plasma colloid osmotic pressure will cause fluid to leak from the intravascular to the extravascular compartment. So the mechanisms of decreased plasma colloid osmotic pressure will be either losses of protein from the body to the kidney, like for example a nephrotic syndrome, or from the liver, like for example a cirrhosis. So these can all lead to facial puffiness, abdominal distension, or pedal edema. Or an increased capillary hydrostatic pressure, which is the mechanism which happens in a heart failure. So you will get a pedal edema and a facial puffiness, abdominal distension if you have a right heart failure. So if you have a right heart failure, it will cause an increase in the capillary hydrostatic pressure in the systemic veins. For example, severe tricuspid stenosis, tricuspid regurgitation, constrictive pericarditis will lead to right heart failure and peripheral edema. So this will not be present in a ventricular septal defect where you will have left heart failure. So here the left heart failure is an increased left atrial pressure and increased pulmonary venous hypertension, which leads to fluid leak into the interstitial compartment and into the alveoli, causing a pulmonary edema. So this is the mechanism of left heart failure in the case of shunt lesions and conditions like cardiomyopathies, mitral stenosis, or mitral regurgitation. So this is about peripheral edema. Then coming to the antenatal history, any congenital heart disease can be associated with any antenatal problems in the mother. So infections in the mother, the classical prototype being a maternal rubella, which causes a triad of a congenital rubella syndrome. He has a deafness. The baby will have a microcephaly, low birth weight, deafness, cataract, and congenital heart disease like a PDA or a peripheral pulmonary stenosis, or sometimes a ventricular septal defect. Infections like TORCH and HIV can cause cardiomyopathies. Mumps can cause endocardial fibrolastosis. And any history of abnormal drug intake could be lithium, which causes Epstein's anomaly, retinoic acid, and some of the anticonvulsants in the mother can cause ventricular septal defects, and alcohol. So if the mother is too much alcohol addict, it can cause a fetal alcohol syndrome where they can have an atrial septal defect, VSD, PD, or tetralogy fellow. So all these symptoms have to be asked. And the main maternal condition you have to be asked is a diabetes. So history of diabetes in the mother, either the gestational diabetes or the chronic diabetes, can lead to hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, transposition of great arteries, and sometimes ventricular septal defect. Other conditions which you can ask is history of SLE in the mother, systemic lupus erythematosus, which can cause a complete heart block or a myocarditis in the baby, and maternal fetal phenylketonuria, which can cause congenital heart disease, microcephaly, and ventral retraction in the baby. So these are part of the routine history taking which you ask in the mother, and some of these conditions can cause ventricular septal defect. So when coming to the birth and developmental history, so if it is a ventricular septal defect not associated with any syndrome, the birth weight of the child will usually be normal. Like our baby had a birth weight full term of 3 kilos, which is a good weight. But if it's having a VST with a low birth weight, you must see if the VST is associated with any syndrome. And usually there will be not many neonatal problems, because usually the heart failure starts around first month of life. So the neonatal course will usually go smoothly in the case of a VST. Then any large shunt lesion like a VEC or PDA will have a malnutrition, and that can be associated with some development delay, which is associated with the failure to thrive. So our baby, for example, had partial head holding at the age of 5 months, where you expect in a normal baby full head holding around 3 to 4 months. So coming to the provisional diagnosis after history. Excuse me. So coming to provisional diagnosis after history. So from the history, we want to see what kind of diagnosis can we get. So we know that the symptoms have been present from near birth, that is from the first month of life. So it is a congenital, it is an asymptomatic heart disease. There was no history of cyanosis. And because of the history of the recurrent respiratory tract infections, failure to thrive, and suck-to-suck cycle, we know it is a congenital asymptomatic heart disease with an increased pulmonary blood flow or a left or right shunt, with congestive heart failure because of the symptoms, and with failure to thrive. So we know from the symptomatology that from the history itself, we can tell that it's a congenital asymptomatic heart disease with left to right shunt in congestive heart failure with failure to thrive. But of course, it's very difficult to find out what type of lesion it is, and maybe the examination will help us with regarding to that. Now, when coming to the general examination, the patient is lying in a mother's lap. There's respiratory distress. He looks malnourished. There's no pallor, jaundice, cyanosis, clubbing, edema, or lymphadenopathy. There's no facial or skeletal dysmorphism. Vitals, the pulse rate is 130 per minute. There's tachycardia, is regular, normal in volume and character. No radio-radial or radiofemoral delay, and no apex pulse deficit. The respiratory rate is 50 per minute. There's tachypnea with subcostal intercostal retractions. The BP is 90 by 60 millimeter mercury in all four limbs. So jugular venous pulse, you cannot see in infants, so you have to see in elder children or adolescents or adults. So we'll skip that. And the saturation was 98% in room air in all four limbs, so there's no cyanosis. Coming to anthropometry, the weight is 4 kilos, which is less than third centile. Height was 62 centimeters, which is third to 25th centile. And head circumference is 42 centimeters, which is the 25th centile. So obviously there's malnourishment from the weight. It's less than third centile. So coming to the cardiovascular system. So cardiovascular system examination consists of inspection, palpation, percussion, and auscultation. So I usually do the inspection and palpation combined, and many of the examiners accept that. So I'll go for the inspection and palpation combined. So the trachea is in the midline. There's no scars, sinuses, or dilated veins. The apical impulse is seen and felt in the left fifth intercostal space, just lateral to the mid-tapical line. It is an LV type of apex. I'll explain that later on. And hyperdynamic in character. There's a left parasternal pulsations. Palpable P2 is present. Palpable second heart sound is present in the left upper sternal border. Auscultation, S1 is normal. S2 is white variable split with the P2 loud. No other additional sounds. Grade 3 by 6 early systolic murmur in the left lower sternal border. And a grade 2x4 mid-diastolic murmur heard at the apex. So respiratory system, respiratory distress with subcostal and intercostal retractions is present. There's a normal vesicular breath sounds, no Krebs or wheeze. There's no hepatosplenomegaly. And central nervous system, the cry tone activity is good, and there is no focal neurological deficit. So now I have to summarize your findings and go for a complete diagnosis. But before we do go there, we'll go through each and every examination finding and see how it relates to history. And then we'll go for a complete diagnosis. So it'll be more understandable. So always you have to look for, you know, that congenital heart diseases are associated with syndromes. So you always look if there's any facial or skeletal features of syndromes. So many syndromes are associated with the presence of a ventricle septal defect. For example, on the left side, you can see the typical baby. I'm sure it's a spotter. You will know what it is. So this baby is having a very jolly attitude, always laughing. He's having a brachycephaly. He's having a mongoloid gland, epicanthal fold. He's having a very large tongue, simian crease. So this is and having associated ventricular septal defect. So this patient is a trisomy 21 or Down syndrome. So the prototype lesion for the Down syndrome is an AV canal defect, but some of them can be associated with the ventricular septal defect. Now, some coming to the lesion on the right. So this baby is having a very large forehead, a hypertelorism, a low set ears, a bulbous nose, absent philtrum, downturned mouth and a small mouth, and a retrognathia. So this patient also is having hypocalcemia and immunodeficiency associated with a ventricular septal defect. So this is a Digott syndrome, which is a 22q11.2 deletion, which is diagnosed by Fish. So the prototype lesion for Digott syndrome is a tetralogy fellow, but sometimes VSTs can also be associated. So why we have to know if the patient is having a syndrome or not? So many of these ventricular septal defects, obviously you're going to take them for a surgery or for a device closure. So there are many other associated abnormalities in these conditions. For example, in the case of a Digott syndrome, he will have associated hypocalcemia or immunodeficiency that might cause problems during surgery. And also these patients may have developmental delay and associated seizures or behavioral disorders. So you have to counsel the parents before taking the patient for surgery. If you don't do that and do the surgery without counseling, and the patient later on develops like some kind of a neurodevelopmental delay or behavioral disorder, they will go and blame it on the surgery. So it's important to counsel them and tell them that these patients are prone for these behaviors even before going for surgery. So that is important to do a complete workup before going for the surgery. Pulse. So usually the pulse is normal in a ventricular septal defect. Our patient had a tachycardia, one heart rate of 130 per minute. That was due to the heart failure. You have to look for the rhythm. So mainly the baby will have a sinus rhythm, but there are some patients may have a very high heart rate, like a 230 per minute. He may have a fever associated with a supraventricular tachycardia, or he can have a very low heart rate which is irregular in nature, like a complete heart block, which can be associated with congenitally corrected transmission of great arteries or with AV canal defect. So it's important to look for the rhythm. It can give some importance for the diagnosis. So volume. The volume will be normal in a ventricular septal defect, but you can get a high volume pulse in a patent ductus arteriosus or a aortopulmonary window, which is due to the peripheral runoff, and you can get a low volume pulse if the patient is in shock. Different characters of the pulse can be present. So VSD will have a normal character, but you can get a pulsus parvus et tardus, which is a slow raising and delayed peaking pulse seen in severe aortic stenosis, a water hammer pulse, which is seen with a patent ductus arteriosus, or a bispirens pulse, which is a double peaking pulse, which can be seen in severe aortic regurgitation. So pulse itself is a separate topic, which we can take maybe if we have time later on. But ventricular septal defect initially will have a normal pulse. And radiofemoral delay. So how do you see that? You simultaneously palpate the brachial pulse and the femoral artery pulse on the same side. Usually they should be occurring together. But in the case of a coarctation of aorta, where you have a brachioradial delay, where the brachial artery will be, the femoral artery will be felt more delayed than the brachial artery, and it will be less volume in nature. So you have to see for a radiofemoral delay. Sometimes VSTs can be associated with coarctation. So it's very important you diagnose this. Then blood pressure will be normal in a ventricular septal defect. So you can have a wide pulse patient in a PDA or an AP window due to the peripheral runoff, just like the high volume pulse. And you can have a low pulse patient if the patient is in shock or in severe aortic stenosis. And you can have sometimes a difference in a blood pressure between the upper limbs and lower limbs. For example, a coarctation, more than 20 millimeter mercury is different. Or a tachyosal arteries, where you can have a difference between the right upper limb and left upper limb blood pressure. The difference of 10 millimeter mercury is more significant. So it's important to take the blood pressure in all the four limbs. Coming to the jugular venous pulse. So jugular venous pulse is basically seeing the internal jugular vein, which gives an indirect measurement of the right atrial pressure. That is, you can diagnose right heart failure or not. So usually you cannot see it in infants. The child has to be more cooperative, basic in elder child or an adolescent or adult. The way we used to diagnose, so JVP will usually be normal in a ventricular septal defect. measure jugular venous pulse was you make the patient go in a 45 degree angle, and then you take the upper column of the internal jugular vein where you see the pulsation, you put a scale, and then a scale from the angle of Louis up to that upper scale, and you measure that distance. So here it is 3 centimeters, and basically the angle of Louis distance from the right atrium is constant, which is 5 centimeters. So 3 plus 5 is 8 centimeters of water, and you can convert it to millimeter mercury by dividing by 1.3. So the normal RA pressure is around 3 to 5 millimeter mercury. So you know if the RA pressure is increased or not. Okay, but now it is accepted that you can see the jugular venous pulse in the sitting posture itself. So in the sitting posture, just make the patient sit and see for the right side internal jugular pulsations, which is present lateral to the sternocleidomastoid. You have to see the three things you have to see. One is the upper level of the column. Next thing is the waves. So the waves itself will is a separate topic itself. But basically, you have 3 positive waves and 2 negative waves. ACV are the positive waves and X and Y are the negative waves. So by that, you can diagnose various lesions. And then the hepatojugular reflux. So the hepatojugular reflux, what you do is, your pressure is applied to the abdomen for around 30 seconds. So the normal response is the JVP rises transiently for a few cardiac cycles and then falls. In the case of a right heart failure, you will have a positive hepatojugular response where the JVP level rises and remains so in that position. So basically, raised JVP means that the patient is having a right heart failure. So it will be, even in an elder child, if you're having a VST, the JVP will be normal. So the hepatojugular reflux depends on the sympathetic tone and the intrathoracic pressure, which means you can get false positive responses if a patient is having a high sympathetic tone like an anemia or thyrotoxicosis, or in a patient who is having increased intrathoracic pressure like a COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, or asthma. So beware of these false positive responses. Coming to the cardiovascular examination, apical impulse. So what is the apical impulse? It is the lowermost and outermost point of definite cardiac pulsation. So you must know what is the normal position of a cardiac impulse in a normal child. So less than 7 years, it is in the fourth intercostal space, just medial to mid-clavicle line. And it is in more than 7 years, it is fifth intercostal space in the mid-clavicle line. So in both in greater than 7 years and in adults and in adolescents. So our child was having in the fifth intercostal space, just lateral to the mid-clavicle line, which means there is definitely cardiomegaly. Then you have to know if it is of right ventricular type, left ventricular type, or biventricular type. This is very important because conditions like ASD, where you have a right atrium, right ventricular volume overload, you will have a right ventricular type. But conditions like PDA and VST, you will have a left ventricular type. And that is can be seen whether it's a right ventricular or left ventricular type by seeing which way it gets retracted. So you'll have a medial retraction in the case of a left ventricular type, and you have a lateral retraction in the case of a right ventricular type. So ours was a left ventricular type of apical impulse with cardiomegaly. So we know that the LV is dilated by clinical examination itself. And then you see the character of the pulsation. A person will have a normal LV type. A person without any heart disease will have an LV type of apical impulse, which will be normal type. So in that type, it will be duration less than 2/3 of systole and confined to 1 intercostal space. If a patient is having a severe aortic stenosis or left ventricular outflow tract obstruction, it will be a heaving type of apical impulse, where the duration will be greater than 2/3 of systole. In mitral stenosis, it will be a tapping type of apical impulse. And in the case of a patient with a volume overload lesion, like for example a ventricular septal defect or a mitral regurgitation, it will be a diffuse type of apical impulse where the apical impulse will occupy more than 1 intercostal space, like in our patient. So our patient had a cardiomegaly with an LV type of apical impulse with the hyperdynamic type of apical impulse, where it was the apical impulse was diffuse, occupying more than 1 intercostal space. So we know that this patient had cardiomegaly, and the cardiomegaly was due to left ventricular enlargement. Then you have to look for pulsations in other areas as well, including epigastric. So this is the heart as it lies in the chest. So if the pulsations you see in the right lower sternal border, it is due to the enlargement of the right atrium. If it is the left lower sternal border, it is due to the enlargement of the right ventricle or the left atrium. If it is the left upper sternal border, it is due to the enlargement of the pulmonary artery. Or if it is the right upper sternal border, it is due to enlargement of the aorta. And enlargement of the LV will lead to pulsations over the apex. That is the LV type of apical impulse. So our patient had a left lower sternal border pulsation, which is most probably due to left atrial pulsations, and left upper sternal pulsations and palpal P2, which is due to the dilated pulmonary artery. So we know that the pulmonary artery and the left atrium gets dilated in the case of a ventricular septal defect. Auscultation, the S1 was normal in our case, so usually it will be normal in VST. Some causes of a loud S1 will be in mitral stenosis, and soft S1 will be in acute severe mitral regurgitation or aortic regurgitation. S2. So the S2 consists of 2 components, an A2, which is the aortic component, and the P2, which is the pulmonary component. So our patient had a wide variable split, and the P2, that is the pulmonary component, was loud. So first we must understand what is split. So a second heart sound normally has a split, that is an A2 component and P2 component are heard separately. So what is normal splitting? So look at this diagram. In expiration, the S2 is single, and in inspiration, the S2 is split. That is normal splitting. So expression single, inspiration split, where the A2 is earlier and the P2 is delayed. So what happens is during inspiration, there's more amount of blood coming from the systemic veins to the right atrium, right ventricle, and going across the pulmonary valve. So the pulmonary hangout interval is delayed. So the pulmonary valve closure gets delayed. So because of this pulmonary valve closure gets delayed, the split is heard during inspiration. So that is normal splitting. So what is wide splitting? Wide splitting means that the split is present both in expression and in inspiration. Okay. So there are two types of wide splitting. One is wide fixed splitting, where you get a neutral septal defect and right bundle branch block, where the amount of split is the same in inspiration and expression. And then you have wide variability, which you can get in conditions like ventricular septal defect or mitral regurgitation. Here what happens is, in a ventricular septal defect, the blood goes from the left ventricle to the right ventricle to the pulmonary artery. So there's less blood going across the aorta because of the blood which is shunted to the right. So the aorta closes early, and then the pulmonary artery, more blood going across the pulmonary artery. So the pulmonary valve closes late. So in expression, there'll be a split. Then during inspiration, there's even more amount of blood which comes from the venous return to the right atrium, right ventricle going across the pulmonary artery. So the split becomes even more during inspiration. So a wide variable splitting is where the split is in expression and the split becomes even more wider during inspiration. So this is present in conditions like ventricular septal defect and mitral regurgitation. So this basically means that our VST is large, or at least moderate site, which is having a significant shunt. If it is a small VST, which is hardly any shunt, it will be a normal splitting. There's a condition known as reverse splitting, which is the opposite of normal splitting. So the baby will have a splitting in inspiration and will have a single sound in expression. So just opposite of the normal splitting. So this paradoxical splitting is seen in conditions like patent ductus arteriosus, left bundle branch block, and severe aortic stenosis. So normal splitting, as I said, the splitting is in inspiration and single in expression. Here the splitting will be in expression and single in inspiration, reverse splitting. So this is a diagram which is showing the splitting. So normal is a single second heart sound in expression and splitting in inspiration. Wide splitting is where the splitting is present in both expression and inspiration. In the case of wide variable splitting, the splitting is there in expression and becomes wider on inspiration. In fixed splitting, the split is the same in both expression and inspiration. And paradoxical splitting is the reverse of normal splitting, where the splitting is seen in expression and it is single in inspiration. Okay, then coming to this is splitting. Now there are sometimes where the second heart sound is single. When the second heart sound is single, it can be single and normal or single and loud. So single and normal basically means that either there's an aortic atresia or a pulmonary atresia, and the component which is heard normally is the other component. So you'll have a single A2 in a pulmonary atresia and a single P2 in an aortic atresia, and that second heart sound will be normal. Then you can have a single and loud second heart sound. So why this single and loud second heart sound comes is in malposition of great vessels. Okay, so I hope you can see my hands actually. So this is the way the great vessels are present in our body. You have the aorta, which is right and posterior, and you have the pulmonary artery, which is left and anterior. So in conditions like, for example, transmission of great arteries, or in congenitally corrected transmission of great arteries, there'll be malposition of the great vessels. So the aorta comes very much anterior, close to the chest, and it can be to the left or to the right of the pulmonary artery. So because this aorta comes very close to the chest, that aortic sound is heard very loud, and the pulmonary sound is not heard because the pulmonary artery is far away posteriorly. So you can have a single and loud second heart sound in conditions which have a malposed great arteries, like a TGA or a congenitally corrected transmission of great arteries. Okay. Then you can have a single and loud second heart sound where both the aortic and the pulmonary component will close together at the same time. So if this is a patient with a ventricular septal defect which is going towards Eisenmenger syndrome and increased pulmonary vascular resistance, you'll have a single and loud second heart sound. So Eisenmenger, ESG and PDM will have a single and loud second heart sound. And sometimes you can have both the A2 and P2 heard with the P2 loud, which is an idiopathic pulmonary artery hypertension. So our patient had a wide variable split, which means it's a large VST, P2 being loud because of the pulmonary hypertension and dilated pulmonary artery. Then coming to the murmurs. So the types of systolic murmurs, you have systolic murmurs, diastolic murmurs, and continuous murmurs. Four types of systolic murmurs are there. You have a pan-systolic murmur, you have a mid-systolic murmur, you have an early systolic murmur, and you have a late systolic murmur. So a small to a moderate size restrictive VST will have a pan-systolic murmur, but a large VST like our patient will have an early systolic murmur. So we'll try to understand why. The upper two conditions are, this is a small VST. So in a small VST, how to differentiate clinically from a moderate VST is, there'll be no left atrial left ventricular dilatation, so no cardiomegaly. A moderately restrictive VSD will have left atrial and left ventricular dilation. So cardiomegaly will be there. So you can even differentiate a small VSD from a moderate VSD by clinical examination as well. So both small and moderate VSD, the RV pressure will be lesser than the left ventricular pressure. So the shunt happens from, because of the difference of the left ventricular and right ventricular pressure, the shunt happens from LV to RV throughout systole. So you will have a pan-systolic movement. But in the case of a large VSD, which you can see the lower diagram, there's a very large hole. So there's an equalization of pressures of the left ventricle and right ventricle. So the blood which shunts during systole definitely cannot shunt throughout the whole of systole because there's an equalization of the LV and RV pressure. So it starts with the S1 and it is an early systolic murmur which ends well before S2. So this is, first one is a pan-systolic murmur which is present in a small or moderate size restrictive VSD which starts with S1 and goes throughout up to S2. And because it goes up to S2, many times you cannot hear the second heart sound. And this is an example of an early systolic murmur which you can get in a large VSD. This is S1. The murmur starts with S1 and it is initially very high pitch. And this is S2 and it stops well before S2. So this is an early systolic murmur in a large VSD. So coming to diastolic murmurs. Diastolic murmurs are of three types. Early diastolic murmur, mid-diastolic murmur and late diastolic murmur. So our patient had a mid-diastolic murmur at the apex. So what is the reason of this? So our patient had a large VSD. Large amount of blood flow going from the left ventricle to the pulmonary artery, going to the pulmonary capillaries, coming back to the left atrium and left ventricle. So this increased flow of blood coming back from the left atrium and going across the mitral valve to the left ventricle causes like a physiological mitral stenosis. So this causes a mid-diastolic murmur. So this is the examples of the early diastolic murmur which you can get an aortic regurgitation. Starts with the second heart sound and ends well before S1. Mid-diastolic, which starts after a gap of the second heart sound, and late diastolic, which is present in mitral stenosis along with the MDM. Okay, so our patient had a mid-diastolic murmur at the apex. So the presence of a mid-diastolic murmur in a shunt lesion like a VSD, PDA, or AP window indicates a large VSD with a significant shunt and indicates that it is operable. That is, needs some treatment, either surgery or device closure. Also, we have continuous murmurs, but I will not go into the details of that. But a patent ductus arteriosus will have a continuous murmur. And coming to the other symptoms will be normal. Respiratory distress was there due to congestive heart failure. So coming to the final diagnosis. So now we know from the history and examination that it is a congenital disease. It is an acyanotic heart disease. It has an increased pulmonary blood flow. So left-right shunt with an increased pulmonary blood flow. And we now know that it is a VSD. So why is it a VSD? We know that it is an early systolic murmur in the lower left sternal border and is having a wide variable split. How do we know it is large? We know that it is large because of the congestive heart failure symptoms which the patient is having. The patient was having a small and moderate VSD, the patient will not have congestive heart failure symptoms. And also the patient was having a cardiomegaly. The patient was having a wide variable split. The patient was having a mid-diastolic murmur across the apex. So all these conditions make us believe that it is a large VSD with pulmonary hypertension due to the palpable P2 and pulsations in the left upper intercostal space. In congestive heart failure, which is obvious, in normal sinus rhythm, and grade 3 IAP malnutrition. Okay, so the final diagnosis will be a congenital acyanotic heart disease with increased pulmonary blood flow, large ventricular septal defect with pulmonary hypertension in congestive heart failure, normal sinus rhythm, and grade 3 IAP malnutrition. So coming to the, now we've got the diagnosis from the history and examination. Now we will go to the evaluation. So first let us, the most important evaluation first is the X-ray and the ECG. Excuse me. So coming to the evaluation. So this is the X-ray of the same patient. So there's many different ways of reading the X-ray, but I will not go in that order. I will just tell you about the cardiac findings due to lack of time. So any cardiac X-ray you want to read, you want to calculate the cardiothoracic ratio to see if there's cardiomegaly or not. So how do you calculate the cardiothoracic ratio? So first you take the maximum concavity of the right border and draw a line to the mid-sternal area. Then the left border, the maximum concavity, and draw to the mid-sternal area. So this will be A and B. And take the maximum diameter of the rib cage. So maximum concavity will be C. Then you do a ratio known as A plus B by C. Multiply into 100, you get a percentage. So in the case of a neonates and small infants, if it's more than 60%, it's cardiomegaly. In the case of larger infants and smaller children, if it's more than 55%, it is cardiomegaly. And in the case of larger children, adolescents and adults, if it's more than 50%, it's cardiomegaly. So from this X-ray, we can easily see that the cardiothoracic ratio is more above 60%. So there is cardiomegaly. Next, we want to know what is the cardiomegaly due to. We know that the chambers dilated in a VSD will be a pulmonary artery, left atrium and left ventricle. So you want to know the cardiomegaly is due to the left ventricle. So you can take an AP X-ray and even a lateral X-ray will help you. But we have taken only an AP X-ray now. So first you see this is the cardiophrenic angle. So if the left heart border dips below the diaphragm, you can see this border is going below the diaphragm over here and forming an obtuse angle with the diaphragm. It is an LV type of apex. So the cardiomegaly is due to the left ventricular dilatation. This is in opposed to this X-ray, which is an atrial septal defect X-ray, another patient. So here the cardiac left cardiac border does not dip below the diaphragm. It ends over here, forming an acute angle. So this is an RV type of apex. The next chamber which dilates is the pulmonary artery. So the left heart border is formed by up to down by the aortic knuckle, the pulmonary artery, the left atrial appendage, and the left ventricle. So here usually the pulmonary artery is concave. So if you get a straight pulmonary artery or a convex pulmonary artery, it means the pulmonary artery is dilated. So here the pulmonary artery is very much dilated. Next, the signs of left atrial enlargement. Okay, so look at this part. So this forms the right atrial border. But if you see another shadow over here within the right atrial border, if you see another shadow, then it is called a shadow within shadow appearance, which is due to the left atrial enlargement. So this is one shadow, the right atrial border, and this is the other shadow. So this is a left atrial dilatation. Another incidence of left atrial dilatation is left atrial appendage enlargement. So when the left atrial appendage is enlarged, it causes straightening of the left heart border. So this is also due to a left atrial dilatation. And this patient's pulmonary arteries will also be dilated. So here, this is the right pulmonary artery. And you can clearly see that the right pulmonary artery is dilated. And the pulmonary blood flow. Normally, the pulmonary vascularity should go up to the middle one-third of the lungs in a normal heart. But in this patient who is having an increased pulmonary blood flow due to the left of the right shunt, you can see the pulmonary vascularity going all the way to the lateral one-third of the lungs. So this is an increased pulmonary blood flow. So this is basically a patient with a large VST which you have diagnosed by X-ray. So the patient will have a cardiomegaly, LV type of apex, a dilated main pulmonary artery segment, a left atrial dilatation, and an increased pulmonary blood flow. So the patent ductus arteriosus will also have the same type of findings. But because in the case of a patent ductus arteriosus, the blood will traverse, the extra shunted blood traverses through the ascending aorta and the aortic arch. You will also have ascending aorta dilatation and aortic knuckle dilatation in the X-ray, which you cannot see in this patient. Then coming to ECG. So when you read the ECG, first we see that the axis is normal. The lead one is positive and AVF is positive. And we know that the left atrium and left ventricle is dilated. So left ventricle dilatation will have the deep S waves in B1 and the tall R waves in B6. And it will be a volume overload pattern. We know that two types of LV enlargement are there. One is LV pressure hypertrophy. One is LV volume overload. So LV pressure hypertrophy will be due to conditions like systemic hypertension or aortic stenosis. LV volume overload will be conditions like VSD or mitral regurgitation. So the diastolic volume overload pattern will be this deep Q waves over here in the lateral leads and tall T waves. So this means that there's an LV enlargement to the volume overload. So these are the conditions of a significant VSD. And many of these conditions will also have patterns of left atrial enlargement, which is seen by the wide P waves in the lead to more than 3 millimeters, but this patient does not have. Okay, so this is the volume overload pattern, which is the deep Q waves and the tall T waves. Okay, so now this is an ECG of our patient. Now, if you take an ECG in an older child with a VST, so when an older child is there who is unoperated with the VST, pulmonary vascular resistance starts increasing and the patient develops a right ventricular hypertrophy due to the VST. So that manifestation starts on seeing on the ECG. So first you do the right ventricular hypertrophy, you will have a right axis deviation. So you will have a equiphasic lead complexes in lead 1 and AVF being positive. So the axis is around 90 degrees and the deep S waves start disappearing and you have a tall R waves in V1, like which is due to the right ventricular hypertrophy. And you will also have tall equiphasic complexes in mid precordial leads like V3, V4, which is an Katz-Watchel phenomenon, which is due to the biventricular hypertrophy. And slowly the diastolic volume overload pattern starts disappearing. Like you have the Q wave is disappearing. You're having a very small Q wave and the T waves are not very tall. So this is what happens when a patient is developing increased pulmonary vascular resistance and going towards Eisenmenger syndrome. So even by means of the ECG also, we can differentiate whether the patient is having a VST with a large shunt or going towards increased pulmonary vascular resistance with a lesser shunt. So ECG findings in a VST, in a nutshell, in an infant, LA and LV enlargement, volume overload pattern and normal axis. In an older child, RV enlargement, no volume overload pattern and right axis deviation. So coming to the echo. So this is not the echo of this patient. I was not able to get it actually. But basically, I will not go too much detail in the echo. So this is the four chamber view. This is the right atrium, left ventricle and right ventricle. You can see the hole over here, which is pointed by the arrow. And here you can see a shunt going from the left ventricle to this red jet in between. So this is a small muscular VST. And because it's small, the left atrium and left ventricle are not dilated. As I said, this is a VST of another patient. So echo is very crucial in the evaluation of VSD. and it can tell us the size of the VSD, the location of the VSD, chamber dilatation, pulmonary artery pressures, any associated lesions like a VSD may be associated with the ASD or with a coarctation, and the ventricular function. So echo is very important to do the proper echo for the patient before we decide the treatment, like whether you're going for a device closure or for a surgery. So what are the types of VSD? So there are four types of VSD basically. So this is the heart where the parietal wall of the right ventricle or the front wall of the right ventricle has been removed. And this is the interventricular septum, which starts, this is the tricuspidal, which starts from here and has a sigmoid and S shape. So it is divided into four parts. This is the membranous septum, which is below the right coronary cusp of the aortic valve. This is the inlet septum below the tricuspid valve, the muscular septum towards the apex, and the outlet septum under the pulmonary valve. So depending where the hole is present, that is the type of VSD. So the commonest is the perimembranous VSD, which is present in the membranous septum. So 80% of patients will have that. Next common is the muscular VSD, which is present in the muscular septum. The inlet VSD just below the tricuspid valve, and the outlet VSD just before the pulmonary valve. So depending on the type of VSD, we can predict the natural history, and also we can decide whether it is a device closure or surgical closure, depending on all these characteristics. So blood investigations don't have that much role to play in the evaluation of VSD. It's mainly supportive. For example, if a patient is having a heart failure with a VSD, you can improve his heart failure status if you correct his anemia. See for signs of infection also by doing a CBC, CRP, and ESR. Then if the patient is a part of a syndrome, you can do a karyotyping or a genetic workup. Like for the Dijot syndrome, you can do a FISH study for 22q11 deletion. And also as part of the workup, you can do an MRI brain if you're suspecting a syndrome or an ultrasound abdomen as part of the syndromic workup. Then treatment is for our patients, this patient's congestive cardiac failure medications were optimized. So the diuretics were optimized for him. And in these patients, you have to give, because the patient is not able to feed properly, the sucrose-suck cycle, he is losing weight. So you have to give high caloric rich, high protein, low volume feeds. That is small frequent feeds because he cannot take a large volume of feeds due to sucrose-suck cycle to increase his weight. And then in older children who have congestive heart failure, maybe due to other cause, you can give a salt restricted diet. And this patient underwent VSD surgical closure and now he is doing fine. So the treatment of the ventricular septal defect, whether device or surgical closure, depends on the size of the VSD. So if the patient is having a small VSD, so these patients basically small VSD, they will not have any cardiomegaly, they will not have symptoms, and they usually get diagnosed when they go for some other cause, like they go for a cold cough to a general physician and he diagnoses and gets a pan-systolic murmur. So these patients who are having a small VSD, they need only medical follow-up, they don't need treatment because their life expectancy and everything will be normal. A patient who is having a moderate VSD, he will have a pan-systolic murmur and some cardiomegaly, but usually he will not have much symptoms of failure or failure to thrive. So you can do elective closure for these patients anytime after 6 months or 1 to 2 years or whenever the person who is doing the procedure is comfortable with the age and the weight. A large VSD like in our patient will have symptoms of congestive heart failure from early infancy. If it is a congestive heart failure which is not able to be controlled with medication, you should do immediate closure. If it is a congestive cardiac failure which can be controlled by medication to some extent, you can do closure by 3 to 6 months of age. So in the VSD closure, whether you do device or surgical depends on the type of the VSD, the age and weight of the procedure, age and weight of the patient. So I'll just give you a small video clip which you got from YouTube, which is showing about device closure. So when you go for the device closure, so this is the groin of the patient. Okay, so you're supposed to put a sheath inside the groin, either in the femoral vein or the femoral artery, depending on which route you're doing. And through the groin, you will put this kind of sheath, delivery sheath, to which you take the device. Okay, then moving forward, you go through the femoral artery. So it goes to the femoral artery, descending aorta, you can see the sheath going, then to the aortic arch, ascending aorta, and then into the left ventricle. So when you go into, this is the four chamber view, right ventricle, left ventricle, this is the VSD over here. So you see the sheath and the catheter, which they go to the aortic valve, left ventricle, cross the VSD, and go into the right ventricle. Then they will load the device. Okay, so now very soon you can see the device which is coming over here through the sheath. And then after that, the sheath will go and move up to the device will go and move to the end of the sheath. And then they, here they are deploying the device. The device here has two discs. One disc will go on the right side of the interventricular septum. The waist will be in the middle. And the other part of the device will go on the left part of the interventricular septum, the left disc. And after that, the cable is released and all the sheaths and everything are taken out. So this is a procedure which is taken around 1 to 1.5 hours and the patient can go home the next day, which is an advantage when compared to an open heart surgery, which takes around 3 to 4 hours, and the patient will have to be ICU at least for 2 to 3 days and will have to be in the hospital for around 7 days. So, but VSD device closure cannot be done in all patients. It depends on the age and weight and the type of the VSD, which has to be always systematically has to be examined. So this is an example of a BSC device closure which we did on another patient. Here you can see the two discs over here and the waist. It is across the interventricular septum. And after putting the BSC device, the left ventricular angiogram is done and there's no shunt which is going into the right ventricle. So complications of these procedures is usually now in the present day, it is less than 1%. BSC surgical closure, you can have in the most dreaded complication is a heart block. So conditions like a perimembranous BSC, which is very, very close to the AV nodal bundle, if it gets damaged during the surgery, it can cause a heart block. Then infection, bleeding, or anesthesia-related complications. BSC device closure can also cause heart block, device malposition, device embolization. So you put the device inside the BSC, but sometimes if the device is not correctly sized to the size of the BSC, it can go into fall into the right ventricle or left ventricle. Then cardiac injury and stroke. So all these complications are less than 1% in today's age. Regarding the follow-up, if there's no major complications during the procedure, the prognosis is very good and the future life of the child will be normal if the child is operated at the correct time. So usually we follow up 1 week, then after 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, and then yearly for around 3 to 5 years, and after that we can stop follow-up. So coming to the natural history of VST. So if the VST is left untreated, what happens? So 80% of small to moderate sized perimembranous or muscular VSTs will close spontaneously by 4 to 5 years of age. We don't have to do anything. So with a small to moderate size perimembranous VST, most of them will close by 4 to 5 years, 80%. So gasolization of VST is sometimes if you have a perimembranous or a muscular VST, the jet which goes and hits the right ventricular outflow tract will cause a muscle hypertrophy and leads to a subvalvar pulmonary stenosis, which can decrease the shunt and cause improvement of the symptoms. Development of aortic regurgitation. So these patients who have a perimembranous VST or an outlet VST, it is very near the aortic cusp. So the aortic cusp will collapse to the VST and it will damage the aortic valve and cause aortic regurgitation. So what happens is the shunt becomes smaller due to the cusp which is collapsing into the VST, but aortic regurgitation starts happening and then the patient develops symptoms of aortic regurgitation with heart failure. And large VST, if unoperated, will lead to an Eisenmenger syndrome. Okay, so what happens if a large VST presents late? So what happens is if the VST is not operated, there will be so much of left to right shunt which is going from the left ventricle to the pulmonary artery. So this increased pulmonary blood flow will lead to a shear stress on the vascular wall of the pulmonary artery, which will lead to smooth muscle hypertrophy in the wall of the pulmonary artery tree. So this increases the pulmonary vascular resistance. So as I said, initially the pulmonary vascular resistance is less than the systemic vascular resistance. So the shunt will be left to right. When the pulmonary vascular resistance becomes equal to the systemic vascular resistance, it becomes a bidirectional shunt. And then when this pulmonary vascular resistance becomes more than the systemic vascular resistance, it becomes a right to left shunt, and then cyanosis happens and they become an Eisenmenger syndrome. So this is an example of a 24-year-old adult where the VST was actually diagnosed, but somehow they refused operation. Now he's coming at the age of 24 years. You can see the cyanosis and clubbing and there's polycythemia of the eyes. So this is an Eisenmenger syndrome. Okay. So we can actually know that the patient is going towards inoperability or increased pulmonary vascular resistance based on the history, examination findings, and ECG X-ray as well. So basically, when the pulmonary vascular resistance starts increasing, the shunt decreases. So there'll be a reduction in the congestive cardiac failure features. There'll be an improvement in the weight gain. Then when the pulmonary vascular resistance becomes more than the systemic vascular resistance, there'll be a right to left shunt and cyanosis manifests. And once cyanosis manifests, it'll be downhill for the patient from there. Ultimately, they will die. Coming to examination, there'll be a reduction of the cardiomegaly and precordial activity. P2 starts becoming palpable more when there's a pulmonary hypertension, S2 becomes single and loud. I said an Eisenmenger VST will have an S2 single and loud. Disappearance of the mid-diastolic murmur across the apex because of the decreased left to right shunt. And onset of a high-pressure pulmonary regurgitation member, which is called as a Graham-Steele murmur. X-ray, cardiomegaly starts decreasing. The LV apex becomes an RV apex. And then the pulmonary blood flow starts decreasing. So you get a pulmonary oligemia and a peripheral pruning. So this example of a X-ray of an the same 25-year-old patient. So here you can see there is no cardiomegaly. So this is in contraindication to the previous X-ray where you saw a huge cardiomegaly, increased pulmonary blood flow. Here there's no cardiomegaly. There's an RV apex. Okay. The lungs are black because there's a decreased pulmonary blood flow. Okay. You can, normally the pulmonary vascularity goes up to the medial one-third of the lungs, but here it's only reaching up to the inner one-third of the lungs. And the central pulmonary arteries will be directed due to the pulmonary hypertension, but they'll be characteristic known as the peripheral. So the dilated go towards the peripheries, the pulmonary artery sizes become less. So this is a peripheral pruning pattern. So this means the patient has reached the stage of Eisenmenger syndrome. So EG, we had seen the ECG in the older child, you will have a right ventricular hypertrophy, decreased LV forces, and no volume overload pattern. echo, very easily we can see that the left atrial, left ventricular overload decreases. There'll be more right atrial and right ventricular dilatation. There'll be right left shunt across the VSD, decreased pulmonary venous return, decreased velocity across the pulmonary valve, high pulmonary artery pressure, and pulmonary regurgitation and tricuspid regurgitation will start being present. So it's very easy to diagnose by echocardiography. The problem of why we want to diagnose these patients earliest, because treatment for Ischemic syndrome is only conservative. Drugs called pulmonary vasodilator drugs, which can give for Ischemic syndrome, but you cannot do any surgery, and ultimately these patients will go downhill and will die. So therefore, it is very important to pick up a large shunt lesion early before the pulmonary vascular resistance increases. That is why we want to operate very large VSTs by 3 to 6 months of age, so that they can be operated and lead a normal life and prevent them from going into Ischemic syndrome. Thank you very much for the patient hearing.